Jesus went about doing good. Amen.
Amen.
Once more, the topic of our message is Jesus went about doing good. As the children of God, we quite acknowledge that God represents every act of goodness and righteousness. And the people that should follow God and worship God have to follow exactly the footsteps of our Lord Jesus Christ in doing good. When we go through the scripture, as soon as Christ began his ministration, in the first place in the book of Matthew chapter 4 verse 17, he said, "Repent ye and start doing what is good, for the kingdom of God is at hand." And when we proceed to verse 23 and 24, and the scripture says, Jesus continued doing good. He keep on delivering the children of God from all these situations. He keep healing the sick. He keep blessing the people of God. Praise the living God. And when we proceed again to the book of Acts of Apostles chapter 10, and verse 38 says, because Jesus was anointed by the Holy Ghost power, and he went about, he keep doing good. All the days of his ministration on earth, he keep doing good. To set a standard for the people of God, for we that should be the followers of Christ, to do good as we are living as well. And when we proceed to the book of Mark chapter 7, and verse 37 says, Christ has done all things so perfectly. All his job have been full of good and righteousness of the Most High God. And we today, as the followers of Christ, how are you doing good in order to follow Christ up? Because we realize after the good works of our Lord Jesus Christ, he went back to heaven. And he commanded us that we should continue doing good in order to meet him up anywhere he will be in his kingdom at the last day. Praise the living God. And if you don't mind that you are having your scripture, please turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 5, and read from verse 16. Matthew chapter 5, and verse 16 says, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works, and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Amen?
Amen.
When Jesus was on earth, he advised the people of God, let your light shine forth before all men. Let your light be a guidance to people to God. For people, for the world to see your good work and glorify your Father who is in heaven. As we acknowledge our Father who is in heaven is the Most High God. And God stands as icon of goodness and righteousness from the beginning. And unto this day, our God is still a good God and continue being good unto his people. Ask yourself a simple question. Are you shining a light to people so that they will know your good work before God? Are you standing as a light in your environment, or in your community, or in your church, for people to glorify God whom you are worshiping? Praise and thank God.
Amen.
And understand that when people are not testifying about your good works, if you are doing none of evil, automatically the name of God has been condemned through you. And at the last day, you will never make it in the kingdom of God. Praise and thank God.
Amen.
This was one of the important instructions that Christ gave to his followers ever before his departure. He said, be a light to your neighborhood. Be a light to your community. Be a light to your church. Be a light to anywhere you are. So that people will see that light. And they will testify of the good work that you are doing. And they will glorify God who has made you in his image. Praise the living God.
Amen.
But unfortunately today, we are very far away from doing good. We the Christians or the churches, we are very far away from doing good. And the name of the Most High God is being condemned because of Christians of our generation. And no God fearing anymore. And young people are no longer interested about worshiping God. Most of us don't even care about the presence of God who they come to worship. Praise the living God. The judgment awaits to I and you at the last day, when we shall stand to account over all we did when we were on earth. If we stand as icon of darkness, sin, and disobedience to the will of God, at the last day, you shall be accountable for these bad things that we did. Praise and thank God.
Amen.
If you don't mind, please turn again with me to the book of Luke. Luke chapter 6. Let us view how our good work is supposed to be before all men. I'm reading from Luke chapter 6, verse 35. And he says, "But love ye your enemies and do good." Amen.
Amen.
Christ keep encouraging us and advising us, the children of God. So even unto our enemies, we don't need to do bad to our enemies. But he says, rather, love those we consider to be our enemies and do good unto them. God did not command us to do good only to the house of God, only to our brothers in Christ, but also to those that we consider as unbelievers. And Christ proceeds to say, "And learn, hoping for nothing again. Any good work we are doing for the sake of God, no matter wherever you are doing those good works to, or the places you are and be doing those good works." And Christ says, "Don't do those good works expecting any benefit from anybody you are helping." Praise the living God. Because your benefit lies with God at the last day. God is the one to repay you of all your good works that you have done on earth while you are living. Praise and thank God. And he proceeds to say, "And your reward shall be great, and ye shall be the children of the highest." Amen?
Amen.
"For he is kind unto the unthankful and to the evil. Since our God is kind, even to sinners." God have no segregation. God keep blessing the sinners and the righteous in order to make sure that these sinners one day will come back to the living God. And Christ is advising I and you. When we start doing good, even to our enemies, our reward shall be great before the Most High God. And you shall be called the son or the daughter of the highest. Praise the living God. So automatically, since Christ did what was good on earth, and he set a standard, a perfect footmatch, for us to continue with those footmatch in doing good so that we arrive where Christ arrived at the last day. Praise the living God.
Amen.
And if you don't mind talking with me, let us still consider the advice of the apostles of Christ. Because I don't understand. After Christ finished his ministration, he did what was good. And his disciples, they followed up. And I believe they did what was good. And that was why this great religion, Christianity, remains unto this day. Turn with me, please, to the book of Galatians, chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 10. And he says, As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith." Amen.
Amen.
And Christ continues speaking through our dear brother Paul. He said, "Therefore, you as a Christian, since you have been opportune to call a child of God," he said, "let us be doing good." God has granted you that opportunity to do good and be like Christ. Now, Paul is encouraging you. You that is a child of God, why not to start doing good? So that at the last day you shall be considered worthy of being a child of God. So that at the last day we have account before God. What we give your account before God when we didn't do what is good. As we keep on seeing lots of criminal activities in churches, as we keep on seeing lots of atrocities that were not mentioned in the churches, it is not time that I'm blaming a particular group of people in the church. But perhaps 90% of the Christians, they have fallen apart from the commandments of God. Praise the living God. And before we can come back to our Most High God, and God will consider us worthy of having that merit and the last day to be with him, we must walk like Christ. Since Christ came here, he did what was good. And the book of Mark 7:37 says, "He has done all things to be so good." Praise the living God. How are you doing good? Ask your brother or your sister by your side, how are you doing good? Praise the living God. Let us now consider those that we consider as unbelievers. If you have your scripture, please sit on with me. Let us consider a history of a woman that doesn't know God. If such people can do good in their days and they will be saved, we have no reason to give to Christ at the last day. Turn with me to the book of Joshua, please. Joshua chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 3. Joshua chapter 2. And verse 3 says, "And the king of Jericho sent unto Rahab, saying, Bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are entered into thy house, for they be come to search out all the country." Amen. And verse 4 says, "And the woman took the two men and hid them, and said to us, There came men unto me, but I wist not whence they were." Praise the name of God. In the history of the people of Israel, when they were on their journey to the promised land, and time came when they decided to send forth the children of God to go and spy out that land, and they went into the land of Jericho, and a woman that they called Rahab, as the scripture accounted, she was a harlot. She's not God-fearing. She had not been reading the scripture. She's not a Christian like I am. But she decided to do what was good. Praise the living God. And now when we come into the house of God, we find out that most of us are informants against the church of Christ. And this is what Christ calls the sin against the Holy Ghost. And Christ says such sin can never be forgiven on earth and in the world to come. Such sin can never be forgiven. Now, when we go to the account of Kings, we read about David and God's encounter. When David decided to number the people of God, because these people belong to the Most High God, they didn't belong to David. David is just a servant. God decided to go to the wilderness and bring him back and make him the king of his people. He has more power and dominion over the people of God. Likewise today, if I'm a pastor, or if you're a pastor, you have more power or dominion over the house of God. Because this church belongs to the Most High God. And Christ considered this to be a sin against the Holy Ghost. And today, we are informants against the government, against the people of God, to the government. And in the case of a woman called Rahab, she's not a God-fearing woman at first. But when she encountered the people of God, she was very careful. And the king sent forth to her, "Get all the two men that came into your house." And the scripture says she hid them. She decided to offend her land. She decided to offend the king's order. And she saved the people of God to walk in lineage of that salvation of the Most High God. And God decided to save her. Your salvation comes from your good work. And when the land of Jericho was being destroyed, because for sure the people of God knows that they must surely overcome, according to the scripture encouraged the people of God to be confident in God, that we have overcome the world and that which is of the world, because greater is that is in the people of God than that which is of this world. And this woman decided to ignore the king's order. She hid the people of God. And she profaned the law of her land by bringing in these strangers. She saved them. She made them to be okay. And she still led them out of the city unharmed by any power. And today, even the kings of this world is not demanding information from I and you. Just a common security agent or whatsoever demands information from I and you against the children of God, and we decide to fall victim, committing sin against the Holy Spirit. What we say I and you at the last day, as we see it to be very open and popular today, so many Africans are informants. And what disturbs me a lot is this. These Africans claim to be Christians from birth. But Rahab, she not a Christian. But she did what was right. And many of the Koreans as well are informants against the Church of Christ. What will be your account at the last day? What will be my account at the last day before the Most High God? Praise the living God. And we read, when God decided to attack that city of Jericho, the whole land was destroyed. The king who demanded for the people of God was destroyed. The forces of that land, they were all destroyed. But God decided to save that woman called Rahab and her entire family. I want you to understand how important your good work is before the Most High God. Your good work can save you from everlasting condemnation. Your good work can save you from poverty. Some of us are poor because of our evil deed. Some of us are sick because of our iniquities. Some of us are encountering disappointments and failures because of our wickedness. But the scripture didn't indicate that Christ was wicked. From beginning, God wasn't wicked. And God says he considered this world to be destroyed because of our sin. And because of his loving kindness and goodness, he now looked forth upon his son Jesus Christ. And he decided to give forth the only gift he's having, for his son to come and die for the sake of I and you, so that we will escape the destruction of the Most High God. That means God is a good God. That means God is a God of compassion. That means that our God is a loving God. And he decided to save us. And when Christ came, he was working day and night, keep on serving the people of God. When you read the account of Matthew 4:23, they said he went throughout the Galilee. He was delivering those that were under demonic bondages. He was healing the sick. He made the blind to see. He made the poor to be rich. He made those that were cursed to be blessed again. And in verse 24 of Matthew chapter 4, and after he has finished his good work in Galilee, he proceeded to Syria. And he started doing good work equally again. Praise and thank God. But I understand what we are lacking today in churches of Christ. When we now go to the book of Acts of Apostles chapter 10 verse 38, and he says, God anointed Jesus Christ with Holy Ghost and power. That was what enabled him to continue doing that good work. As a child of God, you need the Holy Spirit. As I told you some time ago, when God created heaven and earth, it was without form and void, according to the account of Genesis chapter 1. But in verse 2, as soon as the Spirit of the living God moved forth upon the surface, and he says, and the entire surface starts having life. That Spirit of the living God is what will help you to do what is good. And it is what will help you to resurrect at the last day. And it is what will help you to live in the kingdom of God with the Most High God at the last day. Praise the living God. Our message comes more on repentance. Since God stands as icon of goodness, and Satan stands as icon of darkness and evil, it is important for you as a child of God to join God Almighty, to join Christ Jesus, and to start walking behind the disciples and apostles of the Most High God, so that we will make it home at the last day. If Rahab, who has not read the scripture for a single day, what disturbs me a lot is this. She has not read the scripture for a single day. I quite believe that she has not heard from preachers, but she struggled to do what was right. Are you not ashamed of yourself as a Christian that after reading the scripture from cover to cover, we continue with our evil ways? Praise the living God. Sometime a few months ago, a brother came here, and after the message, he went outside angrily. He said, why should he be telling them, don't do this, don't do this? Praise the living God. Once you have read from the scripture, you did not keep to it, you did not believe it. And you are angry simply because you are being asked to turn away from your wicked ways. Where we sin lead this generation. In the generation of Noah, they were so arrogant and so self-centered as this generation. The whole of them, they keep doing what was wrong before God. And when God decided to send forth his angels, go and warn this generation, the angels of God descended. Because man is the most difficult thing that God has made. Snake is loving. Snake will not hurt you except you hurt him first. But man will hurt you without you hurting him. And when God realized that the wickedness of man is exceedingly growing, he sent forth his angels. Go and caution these people so that they will come back to the Most High God. And because of men, we are so wicked. We set up the angels of God, and we use our devilish daughters to seduce them. And they sin against God even as well. And God angrily decided to destroy that world. That world was destroyed. Noah was the only man that was saved with his family. Now consider about the city of Sodom and Gomorrah, equivalent generation like our generation. But Christ warned us in the book of Matthew. He said, in the day of judgment, Sodom and Gomorrah may be considered worthy, but this generation will never be considered worthy. Because Sodom and Gomorrah, nobody thought them. They were not properly educated the way this generation was being educated. When we go to our theological college, I tag that theological college as a criminal, one of the most criminal organizations on earth. I've never seen anything good coming from theological college. But we see criminal activities, criminal senses, out of the pastors that theological college are producing. We have not seen any repentance from them. Praise the living God. But the judgment of God is individually. It is not collective. At the last day, who shall stand to say what we have done? I come to see so many pastors that are having 2 certificates, 3 certificates, 10 certificates. But the worst is that I don't know if they are reading the same scripture we are reading. But we have not seen any good work from them. What now categorizes them to be the disciples of Christ of this day? Praise the living God. Let us proceed, please. Turn with me to the book of Ephesians, chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 8. If you are there, say amen.
Amen.
Ephesians chapter 6, verse 8 says, knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be born or free. Amen?
Amen.
And St. Paul is not showing I and you. He said, whatsoever that anyone is doing on earth, the same you will surely receive from the Most High God. Are you doing good while you are living? The scripture says, you must surely receive good. There is no doubt about that. There is no mistake about that. You will not be misquoted in the last day. They said it is a mistake. We give you the word of Christ while they are having the word of Satan. He said, no matter anything you are doing, are you bound or are you free? Are you rich or are you poor? Are you white or are you black? At the last day, whatsoever we do while we are living, that we will receive. Are you a pastor or are you a member of a church? Despite what you are in the church, you must surely receive what you have sowed. When Judas was on earth, I consider this generation to be a kind of lineage of Judas Iscariot. Judas went about with Jesus. From the beginning of his ministration to the end of his ministration, he knew that this man came from heaven. He saw the great signs and wonders from Christ. But yet, he refused to repent. And when he sinned against the Holy Ghost, he was not forgiven because he is an immediate disciple of Christ. But he died and he goes to hellfire straight. So let you understand that whatsoever we do, myself, whatsoever I did while I'm on earth, I shall receive that from the Most High God. That is what St. Paul is cautioning I and you. So that we will behave as the people of God. So that we will follow the living God in truth and in spirit. So that we will be known of good. According to the book of Matthew chapter 5, Jesus is telling I and you, we need to be light. So that wherever we are, people will keep seeing this good work in I and you. How are people viewing you wherever you are? In the building where you are living. What is your recommendation in that building? Are they referring to you as a God-fearing man? Are they referring to you as an innocent man? Are they referring to you as a drunkard? Are they referring to you as a chain smoker? Are they referring to you as a demonic person? Or are they referring to you as a child of Christ? Praise the living God. The scripture says, Christ says, let people see your good work and glorify that God whom you are worshiping. Praise the living God. If you don't mind that you are having your scripture, please come with me. Let us see those that did good work while they are living. So we need our Bible text for the day. The book of Acts of Apostles, chapter 9. I'm reading from verse 36. If you are there, say amen. Acts of Apostles, chapter 9, 36, and he says, now there was a Joppa, a certain disciple named Tabitha, which by interpretation is called Dorcas. This woman was full of good works and armies which she did. Amen. Amen. The scripture is telling us of an account of a woman called Dorcas. And the scripture says she is full of good works. She imitated the footsteps of Christ. She kept helping the poor. She did not work against the poor. The scripture indicated she's full of good work in her arm deed, helping the poor. God has made the poor for a purpose, for you to help the poor, for those that are privileged to help the poor. How are you helping the poor that is within your surrounding? What is your good work to those poor? God cannot come down from heaven for you to help God. God doesn't need our help. But God has provided those poor to surround us so that we shall help them and God will rejoice and bless us. Remember the account of Lazarus and the rich man. Lazarus was there. He was a beggar. He was suffering. And the rich man refused that he will not feed from his leftover. He refused to take care of this poor man. And time keep going. Because we know each and every one of us must surely pass away. Are you rich or are you poor? You must surely pass away. And time comes, both of them passed away. Lazarus died, and the angels of God came down and picked him. And the rich man died, and he was kicked over to where he was supposed to be. And the scripture keeps teaching us that there is no opportunity for you to come back again and amend those your ways. When this rich man was pleading, give me a second chance, God said there is no second chance. He pleaded, let the prophets or the angels, let them go to my family members and ask them to amend their ways. And the scripture said, no. For I have provided my prophet, my messengers there on earth. Let them know what the scripture says. Let them know what God says. If they will not listen to those messengers of God on earth with them, they will never listen to the angels that will come down from here. Praise the living God.
Amen.
All these accounts of scriptures is teaching us on how to amend our ways as we are living. In the book of Psalm chapter 6 and verse 5 says, in the graves there is no more remembrance of God. In the graves there is no more repentance. Once you have gone down to the graves, you must stand before God. Praise the living God.
Amen.
and verse 7 says, "And it came to pass in those days that she was sick and died. Whom when they had washed, they laid her in an upper chamber." Amen. What takes away some of our problems on earth is not prayer. It is the good things that we are doing. It is the good things that I'm doing. Prayers is not enough to take away certain misfortune, to take away certain death, to take away certain sickness. But your good work is enough to take away certain misfortunes out of your life. Consider the stinginess among us. If God gives you all he was having, God decided to give it to I and you, which is Jesus Christ. And when Jesus Christ came, he decided to give all he was having. He gave his life, he gave everything. He gave all the blessings he was having. And he tried to salvage us and bring us back to God again. And when the disciples of Christ came, they followed the same footsteps. They gave all that they were having. They did not accumulate riches for themselves, but they accumulated for the people of God, and they helped the people of God. They were not occultic. Now, if I and you, when we say we are pastors and we are occultic, we attack our members, the Church of Christ, is it not an abomination? Before the Most High God, it is a sin that will never be forgiven. When God opened my eyes, I saw so many things. I laughed. One thing is for sure. The judgment of God is coming with his recompension. God will surely reward you. There is reward for all the wicked things we are doing. Look at the scandals about pastors here and there. And they say nobody should say those things. They are anointed men of God. When we see what is evil, anointed men of God, we still say what is evil. Praise the living God. It is not helping the body of Christ, but it is destroying the body of Christ. The people we are attacking, what do they do to us? What is their sin? If I should ask. I come to see so many abominations in churches, among the pastors and ministers. The people we are attacking, how are we saving them to Christ? How are we returning these people to come back to Christ? What is that goodness that these people will stand and testify that God is good? They came to Christ with little problem, and we, the ministers and pastors, we multiply their sorrows and problems. Who is coming to God with 20% of problem? Now we have this problem to be 200%. Is it not an abomination? What is that good work that you will boast before God today? If I'm going to God, this is my good work. What is that? Praise the living God. And the young ones that come to God, to the church, to mishandle the Church of Christ, it is the same equally. Praise the living God. I proceed to verse 40. And verse 40 says, "Then Peter put them all forth and kneeled down and prayed, and turning him to the body said, Tabitha, arise. And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up." Praise the name of God. This woman was raised again from death because of her good work. And God decided to add more years for her. It is because of the good work that she was doing. Because people gathered. We have seen community where people die and people were very happy. People keep on saying, "Yes, God has taken away this evil man." Do you want your death to look like such a death? Because when men are happy that you have passed away, the angels of God are happy that evil man has been taken as well. Praise the name of God. If you don't mind, please turn again with me to the book of Romans. Let us consider the advice that Paul continued advising the children of God. Romans chapter 12. I'm reading from verse 9. And he says, "Let your love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. And the apostle of God keep on encouraging I and you. Anything that is bad, let us go away from those things. Because it is not of Christ. It's anything that is of evil, let it be irritative to us. Because it is not glorified in the name of God. He can now advise you and said, cleave to what is good. Christ is good. Cleave to Christ, which is good. Praise and be God. Our final quotation and the conclusion of our message is taken from the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 15. If you are just saying amen. And he says, see that none render evil for evil unto any man. The scripture is encouraging you, even when they offended you. He says, don't pay back evil for evil to any man. Is it to your brother or sister in Christ? When they offend you, forgive them for the sake of Christ. Don't retaliate. The scripture is warning you. The scripture is warning me. We should not pay back evil to evil. No matter those that have offended us. No matter the rest of the provocation. He said, please don't do this. Because it is not of God. When Christ was teaching us on how to pray in Matthew chapter 6. He says, Father, we should pray. Forgive my sins, my trespasses. As I forgive those that trespass against me. That was what Christ taught us. You will not go contrary to what Christ has taught you as a child of God. And the scripture proceeds to say, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. And he says, continue with that which is good in the church of Christ, in your community, wherever you are, in your working place. The scripture encouraged you. Continue with that which is good, so that at the last day, according to the book of 1 Timothy, he said, at the last day, our treasures that we have piled before God will help us to go into that kingdom of God. This is the end of our message. Amen. May our Heavenly Father bless you all and give us the power of the Holy Spirit to do what is good in Jesus' name.
Amen.